You're on.
Oh, good. Here we are. The County Connection. It's a program about county government with members of county government. And we're very fortunate this evening. We have Commissioner Kevin Barnhardt.
Thank you. Thanks for having me, Jeanne.
Yes, I appreciate that you're here.
You're welcome.
I'd like to start with what maybe everybody's first question to you these days, the bridges.
The most frequently asked question is the bridges crossing Reading and our western neighbors.
Yes.
What would you like to know?
I would like to know what's happening on Buttonwood and what the prospects are for the Penn Street.
Most often people see the lights are going up now on the Buttonwood Street Bridge and they assume it's completed. Well, it's not completed. Okay. It's still on schedule to finish by April, which was the original target date. We have been blessed with some pretty decent weather for the most part, so they are on schedule. There is some built-in time in a contract that long, about a year and a half, I think it was, a built-in for some inclement weather, but things are going along well.
Great.
There's still some improvements that need to be made over the portion, over the bypass.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
But for the most part, they're moving right along, which then, once that's open, actually tonight, as we speak, they're starting to mobilize on the Penn Street Bridge.
Uh-huh.
Now keep in mind, the same contractor, J.D. Ekman, is doing the Buttonwood Street Bridge and was awarded the contract on the Penn Street Bridge out of Atglen, Pennsylvania. But they are just mobilizing. They're bringing equipment and things in for the Penn Street Bridge. So there will be some scattered lane restrictions at night until they get some of their equipment in there on the Penn Street Bridge. But no actual physical work will be seen on the Penn Street Bridge till Buttonwood opens.
Yeah.
And then that will allow... It's about 33,000 cars a day back and forth across the Penn Street Bridge. Buttonwood's about half that, 16, 17, something along those lines. So those people then will divert to Bingham Street or to the Buttonwood Street Bridge to get in and out of the city or take the longer route down the bypass, the Warren Street bypass in Schuylkill Avenue or 61 or 5th Street. So our bridge is coming to completion. It was slightly over. Slightly in relative terms, the actual construction cost is about 3.2 over, and that really deals with most of the concrete deterioration. And they can estimate so much, but until they physically get in and start chipping away at some of that deteriorated concrete,
renovation always costs more.
It just became more.
Yeah.
The original budget, I think, for Penn Street was in the $35 million, $32 to $35 million. That's coming in over $42. Now, that sounds like it's way out of whack, but keep in mind, J.D. Ekman did the Buttonwood Street Bridge, so they've seen and experienced what's taking place on these roadways, so we think that one's more accurate. Now, that's a PennDOT road, the Penn Street Bridge is, and that's going to be restricting lanes, one lane coming into Reading, and two lanes will remain going out till the bitter end, till the last couple months, and this is going to be over 2 years now. It's a much longer bridge. And much more complicated. Obviously, ours was, the Buttonwood Street was about $16 million. This one's going to be $42.5 million. So that one's going to take longer, and it's going to inconvenience more people.
Yes.
The upside for the folks in West Reading, the lane restrictions. Yes. The lane restrictions in West Reading will go back to what they were before.
Right.
So the lane restrictions will be lifted.
Right.
So you'll be able to turn, if you want to, on 3rd Avenue, turn on 4th Avenue. So that'll all be changed around.
I can see the disadvantage once the traffic hits the Buttonwood Street Bridge. I won't be able to get off Topahaka for my life.
Many of us drive that way. Leaving Reading, heading through West Reading, seemed to relieve a lot of any kind of bottlenecks of people backing up into West Reading. Mm-hmm. But one of the factors that everyone had to combat was coming in the other way, coming eastbound through West Reading into the city was backed up. Those, again, were people we think probably otherwise used the Buttonwood Street Bridge to come into Reading. So, and then ultimately, there are no plans on the table yet, but there are plans for rehabilitation of Buttonwood Street, Bingham Street, further down.
Yeah.
So Schuylkill Avenue was first, Buttonwood, and then Penn, and then ultimately Bingham Street. Mm-hmm. And then we look at the Major League project, the bypass.
Yes.
Which I think the engineers are scratching
their
head.
Shall we have a south of Penn Bridge?
Yes, yes, no south of Penn Bridge. But there are, I think, over a dozen bridges and overpasses from the Park Road extension down through Exeter Township. Right. So you don't think there's a lot until you actually traverse that and go, holy cow, there's a lot more elevated surface which is a lot more complicated than your on-grade surfaces to actually rehabilitate. So I think that's going to be several hundreds of millions of dollars.
Easily.
And there's a lot of alternatives being looked at to relieve traffic flow, to relieve. They're talking about eliminating the cloverleafs there at Penn Street, just doing away with cloverleafs and actually putting in signalized intersections, cross intersections, which they claim will reduce traffic. So they're not talking about roundabouts there just yet.
We're going to take a roundabout.
They want to perfect. Yeah, they want to perfect those on 222 North before they decide to put those at the Penn Street Bridge.
I remember the hassle when they put that in, screaming and hollering, and of course, we sort of lost about three blocks to the borough that way.
Really? Yes, the bypass.
Right.
Yes.
There was consternation for that, and we lost a hamburger joint that was right off the bridge that everybody went to.
SO Station, right?
Yes. Browns, it was.
Browns SO Station?
No.
Oh, the diner was Browns.
Yes. My father and Mr. Brown were friends, so he would have coffee and a burger there almost every day.
And they wouldn't think
day.
About relocating it up the hill?
No, he'd had enough.
Oh, he cashed out.
Yeah, that's it. Gone.
But these bridges were built. Penn Street is over 100 years old. Binghamton is probably 85, 90 years old. Mm-hmm. They had some rehabilitation work done in the 60s and 70s, but nearly not enough to actually do a full rehabilitation. And, you know, some people would say, well, gee, you're putting a lot of money into a bridge. Wouldn't it be cheaper and easier to take it down? Well, they're historically valuable and relevant. Butwood Street has historic value restoration, and so does Penn Street. Yeah. So there's also on Penn Street, there's going to be LED lights under it. Since that's been deemed, obviously, the gateway in and out of Reading,
there's
going to be LED lights on the arches, which will really set the bridge off once it's completed. Okay. So there are plans there for traffic reconsideration coming over on the Reading side that people will be able to detour around through there. But I think, again, we had a lesson to learn with Buttonwood Street. People figured it out. People figured out on Schuylkill Avenue. The locals know how to. They know, they're like, it's like water finds its own, seeks its own level. I think it's the out-of-towners, the people that come in for events and things that aren't normally here get a little frustrated, but.
Yeah, well, somewhere along the line I acquired some history of West Reading, and I don't know where it came from, but apparently where the bridge coming into West Reading is now was part of a ford that the Indians used going west.
Really?
Up over the hill by where the railroad is now. So we're still in the same general area as we move west.
Wow.
And I don't remember who wrote the data, but it was interesting that it hasn't really changed. We still follow, 66 was an old pathway forever. We don't have that one anymore.
No.
Well, yes, we do. It's still there. I think it's a yard sale thing.
Now, I don't know how many variations of Penn Street Bridge there were, but I'm sure there were wooden ones many, many years ago, and I'm sure there was a steel structure, but now this concrete, I guess they figured that was going to last forever, but road salts and chemicals and things like that really
do. Nobody ever thought that that was not impervious.
It's the number one issue with the bridges is
the viaduct. That's a marvel of artwork.
Yes. It's actually going the wrong way, right?
Yes.
It's supposed to go this way, it goes that way.
Right. And it's, you know, over land, not water, essentially. Mm-hmm. And it's a beautiful thing to look at. And I guess it's on the historic listing.
Register.
But, you know, they did that, and it was not an easy thing to do. And people would wander around in there and pick up the paving stones. I've got some of them.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Use them in the backyard.
You're just full of stories and history tonight, aren't you?
So I also have a chunk of limestone from the excavation across the street.
Are you allowed to have taken all this stuff?
Hmm?
Were you allowed to take all these things? And
I would ask for it.
Okay. You were building a rock garden, I guess.
Right. No.
No.
I was paving.
Okay.
But in the case of the front yard, I wanted something with a big tree.
Mm-hmm.
I talked to one of the workmen, and he said, well, we've got lots of them. Come on over and pick one, which is what we did. And then they brought it in and installed it.
Take a wheelbarrow over?
No, little...
Hand truck.
No.
Shopping cart.
No.
From the old Acme.
Powered.
That's all right. It's you got it across the street.
Yes. It was not easy to do, and they got it over and
sure
installed
it.
They had a good time. Deciding on the placement and exactly
one less rock they had to worry about, right?
Well, they had endless rocks.
Mm-hmm.
Probably if they'd looked really closely at that, we wouldn't have that development because it took 3 years to dig.
Oh, yes, and that's no different than when they expanded Borough Hall in West Reading. It was a change order to some outrageous magnitude. I think it was another $100,000 or $200,000, yeah, because, gee, we hit rock.
Yeah.
Wait a minute. Maybe you should have figured that out when you knew you were going to try to build on a piece of granite.
Uphill. Hospital's way down there.
Mm-hmm.
Why would you think that the hospital wouldn't have been,
There's a reason why the hospital's like that.
Yeah.
They didn't want to jackhammer and blow everything up.
Right.
Just build it that way.
I just think that the engineers aren't as well trained as they used to be.
Mm.
Also, their prospects are much better today than they used to be. The work that the county has done on bridges is a little different.
Yes.
You have lots and lots of little bridges here and there, some of which are county responsibility.
Yes.
And some are just, somehow or another, somebody has to figure out what to do with it because they're not going to last long.
So the overwhelming majority of bridges in the county of Berks are state-owned.
Right.
Then the next tier is municipally owned. Municipalities, Muhlenberg, right. Spring, Reading. And then we originally started 9 years ago with 63 bridges.
Mm.
We're down to 59.
Mm.
We've removed two. Mm-hmm. We're in the process of removing two more.
Mm-hmm.
And we're turning back two. We're turning back a bridge in Maiden Creek Township, mm-hmm, and turning back a bridge in Greenwich Township to the local municipalities. Most of the county bridges connect one municipality to a different municipality, township to a different township. These generally are more like Maiden Creek to Maiden Creek, right, Greenwich to Greenwich, so it was a little bit easier to sit down with those township folks and say, look, this isn't a regional asset, this is more of a local use bridge, and frankly, the county really doesn't have a critical need for it to move traffic in and out of the community, mm-hmm, so if you're interested in it, we will rehabilitate it for you, or replace it and turn it over to you. We were in Colbrookdale Township about 2 weeks ago. Mm-hmm. We have three bridges in Colbrookdale, Eastern Berks County, two of which we discussed with the township supervisors, and one is kind of a convenience bridge. There's a handful of people live on the road who use it because it's a little bit shorter than going on the other bridge. So we proposed to turn over the one bridge that would continue to operate if the township was interested, but we would like to remove the other one.
Mm-hmm.
We don't believe the township will take the first bridge, but we believe they will be supportive of us taking the one bridge down. We're going to have to put a cul-de-sac in at the end of the road.
Yeah.
So the handful of people that live there, when they get down the end, they can turn around and go back out. In Washington Township, we're doing the same thing, mm-hmm, as we speak. We're taking out a bridge, but we're putting a cul-de-sac at the end,
mm-hmm,
so that people that were... dependent upon going the other way can now turn around and go back out.
Okay.
And for emergency equipment, fire apparatus and ambulances and things can make their way in and out. So we enacted the $5 optional registration fee.
I hear about that.
And people say optional. Well, it was part of Act 89, 2013, the wholesale price of gas legislation, which permitted counties at their option to impose a $5 fee annually on every registered vehicle in the county. And we're the 14th county out of 67 to impose that.
Okay.
And we believe it's going to generate a little over $1 million, we're hoping more than $1 million per year, that we can add to our liquid fuels money.
Uh-huh.
So we can accelerate the amount of bridges that get rehabilitated, repaired, and replaced in the county assets of the 59. Now, we're not caught up anywhere close to where we should be. For decades, the county neglected its bridges. I guess they prioritized other programs.
They had other things to do.
And we closed one too many bridge and detoured, restricted weight, and all that. So we had enough of that. So we're really concentrating, mm-hmm, on rehabilitating these bridges, either removing them, trying to turn them back to the local municipalities, or rehabilitating them. So we're going to be making some steady progress. So we think at least over the next 10 years, if not a little bit longer, to be able to really concentrate on our local bridge inventory.
Okay. I want to put the phone number up because I want to talk about the budget.
Sure.
610-478-0426 to join us. We're going to, if you have questions about the county budget, which is...
$501 million. That's an important subject.
That's absolutely.
Largest single budget of, obviously, of any local government or municipality in the county is the county budget, $501 million. Now, that sounds a little crazy.
Yes.
That's not all local property tax. About $136 million of that is your local property tax that you pay the county in March with your municipal bill.
Right.
And it's about 7.32 mils.
Yeah.
So on an average $100,000 home, that's $732 and change. So that's the county tax bill.
Mm-hmm.
That goes to numerous things within the county, but the balance of that money, I'd say, don't quote me, it's probably in the 60 percentile, 60-65%, is passed through state and federal money.
Mm-hmm.
That's for the human services, like domestic relations, mental health, developmental disabilities, counsel and chemical abuse, children and youth services. Those programs that are state mandated programs, federal government says you will care for your children. Federal government says you will care for your mentally ill folks. You will care for your developmentally disabled on down the line. That money comes to the state. State adds a little bit to it. Not much. Office of Aging is included in that number too. And then comes down to the counties. The counties are responsible to carry out those duties for the state.
Right.
So that's where, when the state doesn't pass a budget July 1st, that the counties end up suffering,
right,
and the school districts end up suffering, because back in the Rendell years, when they had the 102-day budget impasse, 101, 102 days, there was court-related issues that came out of that.
Mm-hmm.
One is that it isn't for the employees to suffer. So now you see business as usual in Harrisburg.
Mm-hmm.
PennDOT's working, Turnpike's open, liquor stores are open, lawmakers are working, their staff's working. So there's really no pain in Harrisburg.
Yeah.
The pain comes down to the counties, because now that money going for human services, what we're required to do for the state,
right,
doesn't come through. And the school districts, many of them receive 20, 30, 40% of their funding from the state, all of a sudden doesn't come down. So in that prior year with the first, I think it was Wolf's first year, and the State House and Senate, that went an extended period of time. We actually outlaid about $24 million out of our surplus.
Right.
We're one of the few counties that had that kind of money to pay human services employees without laying them off. Other counties laid some people off. They went out and loaned money and took out lines of credit at interest rates. So when the state decided to go off the dime and say, we're going to pass a budget, we're going to start the money flowing, all of a sudden they forgot about people having to go out and loan money to provide the services they're required to do. What makes this worse is that the County Commissioners Association fall conference, we know this is going to happen again. Because all they do is Band-Aid the problem. They don't solve the overarching problems. They have a structural deficit, which means revenue is not enough to cover expenses. Year in and year out, they patch it up and they say, we have a balanced budget, and you go home for the summer. Well, it's worse now than ever was.
Yes.
The numbers are now in the $2.5 to $3 billion budget deficit. They're going to go into this year, into their fiscal year, with a deficit, and then compound that with next year's deficit. So we think there's going to be an awful lot of wrangling and finger pointing, and we're not going to raise taxes. We're willing to back and forth and back and forth. So again, we don't think the counties are going to really be in a real good position again come July of this year. That's no fault of ours, but that's the fault of our parents up there in Harrisburg who require us to do these works. Now,
I have a track record that's embarrassing.
Yes, it's embarrassing.
And essentially, they're taking their pay and going home and having a good time, and the county is making up the difference for children and youth, particularly the judicial system.
Here's an appalling number. I'll get to the $138 million one.
Okay.
Here's an appalling number. They leave July 1st, budget or no budget. They go home for the summer. The summer. They have about 10 or 12 session days from Labor Day till the end of the year. So they're literally actually in session about 10 to 12 days in the fall.
Right.
Now, who's making the decisions? Handful of people.
Right.
About four or five senators, about eight or 10 House representatives, and everyone else is just caught up waiting for the phone to ring and say, you have to come out on the floor, we have to pass this, we have to pass that. Leadership tells them to get out on the floor, leadership tells them how to vote. Now, back to the 136 to 138, which is local money, that, a big part of that is criminal justice, which is the sheriff's department, the courts, the district attorney's office, and the jail. Right. That is about, I think, about $86 million of the 136. Don't quote my numbers exactly, but it's the lion's share of that money.
Right.
The jail gets not a penny from the state or federal government. The district attorney's salary is paid about 60% by the state. So everything else in the DA's office, detectives, the assistant district attorneys, and the courts.
Yeah.
We're in a state where it's called a unified court system, where the state is actually supposed to pay the cost of the court system.
We're sitting in this.
They pay for administration, which is the court administrators, about four or five of them, and then they pay the judge's salary and a portion of the judge's staff, which has been cut.
Yeah, of course.
It went from about $70,000 to about $42,000. Now, think about the judges have three employees.
Yeah.
Just a salary and benefits isn't covered by one of those $42,000 nuts. So that, again, gets pushed down to local taxpayers. So the state is remiss in doing their responsibilities. Of course, they want to balance a budget and not raise taxes.
Not really.
So it ends up down below. Parks and recreation, which we're very proud of in the county, is paid for, other than grants for some rehabilitation and building. That's all local tax dollars. A library system. We support the local libraries, about $3 million. We're the local sponsors of Reading Area Community College. That's over $3 million. Mm-hmm. So when you talk about 136, 138,
it gets smaller and smaller.
It gets down to there, and it's all gone.
Yeah.
And it doesn't hurt long.
The other thing that is really wrong with Harrisburg is the apportionment. And I've been on about three committees so far to try to get that under control so that...
And how are you making out?
Well, I don't feel represented,
no.
Put it that way. And I don't think there are very many people in the state of Pennsylvania that actually have a representative that they could nail down.
You know, they've told us that when it comes to Washington or Harrisburg, the more representation you have, the better you are, right? So now we have, do we have four congressmen?
I think so.
We have, we have three, and I think it's three or four.
Little portion.
And I think if you add up the number of U.S. State senators and state representatives, we probably have 14 in total. Do you feel better represented? It's amazing when even somebody like me in public service kind of scratches his head and has to think twice about which part of my township is represented by which congressman,
yes.
Which part of my own township is represented by which state rep and which state senator. It's confusing. And you look at the maps, it's even more horrifying.
Yes, it is.
It's not only that you don't really know, you have to get out a map and say, gee, I had a constituent.
I live on this side of the street, and people across the street have somebody else.
New Hamburg Township's a perfect example. Gee, where do you live? Let me get out the GPS map and figure out which congressman you should call for that certain request that you have. It's hard for us to do that. Now, granted, immortalized Gus Yatron. You knew who your congressman was. Gus Yatron was the Berks County congressman, and you knew you had a problem, a situation.
He called Gus's office.
Period. That was it.
That's the last time.
And that was pretty easy.
Yeah.
And we felt as though we were represented because we had our own congressman there. So it's not that hard to do. There's computer modeling that's done for everything these days.
Yes.
They can't spit that data into a computer and say, we need so many people represented by a district. We have 20 congressional districts. Scope out the state in 30 seconds. It'll spit it out. There you go.
Yeah.
There's your congressional districts. There's your state house. There's your state senate.
It's not likely to happen. And that's too bad. We've run out of time almost. I have about a minute left. And I would ask home viewers, if you're interested at all in this issue, get on whatever representative you can find it. Nail them down and insist that they change the system before we get to the census, which is
2020.
Right. 4 years from now.
Time flies.
If you don't call now, it'll be too late. And I'll say good night and thank you.
Thank you. Good night.
I will not be back next week, I don't think, but I'll see you soon.
Take care.